Hey out there, this is Thursday, October 22nd, 2020. And it's just about 5 minutes past 10 in the morning here in Northern California. I just talked for an hour and a half, and my microphone wasn't connected properly. That little clip at the beginning there, that's the Young Rascals with their song Get Together from 1967. Boy, I sure wish we had done that back then, but we haven't. You know, we've become divided, and this is by design, divided by design. But anyhow, listen, I am going to really, really try to cut it short because I just can't spend another hour and a half talking today. So the gist of what I wanted to talk about today has to do with a tiny critical mass of corrupted clowns that are controlling us. And I don't just mean us as human beings, but us, the United States. And by extension, when you control the United States, you control the rest of the world. It's a default position because America being the most influential nation on earth, being as we have the world's reserve currency, you see. And it basically, you know, if there is a Satan's throne like the Bible talks about, it would be whoever heads up the Federal Reserve. So if there's a devil, he doesn't have horns. He looks a little like the Federal Reserve Chairman du jour. And so you can guess who that might be at any given time. Kind of like that movie They Live. Though I haven't seen it, I get the gist of it. And the gist of it is that there's a lot of people that are really, they're not human, kind of. They're just demonic in their behavior. But the job of the righteous is to reach these people because God loves all his children the same, even the stinkers, which would be enemies of God and man. Basically, those are the stinkers. But we're not to condemn them. The righteous are to reach out to them and try to win them over as friends for God and servants. So the mission is very clear for the righteous. We need to hunger and thirst for righteousness to be the rule of the day upon the earth. And that's going to be at the hand of God and in God's timing. But that time looks like it's approaching, which is very good news for the righteous. We've had a long period of evil at the hands of the money masters of misery. When it comes to things that are bugging you, you got to separate it into two categories. One category being organic stuff. That's across the board. It's necessary suffering for now until the renewal of all things. And it is invented suffering. And the other type, that is the artificial suffering, is invented. And it is selective. It is not across the board. And it has everything to do with money. Money is how the evildoers get away with what they do. And it's really very simple. And, I don't know how much more I can expand on that concept that people really need to understand. There's a huge departure from the way God sees things and the way the world sees things, the way the world defines things and the way God defines things. The values of God and the values of man are often opposed. They are diametrically opposed to each other. They're antithetical. Is a term I was looking for, antithetical to one another. So when God sets up his kingdom on earth, there will not be any form of money. From all the research I've done on economics, I've come to that conclusion. It's very clear there can't be any form of money because it's just a method of stealing from others, to control others, to having a one-up on others, an advantage. Okay, that's all it does. And so the people that love that would hate a perfect world. They're going to hate the world that God plans on establishing. So God cannot be stuck between a rock and hard spot forever, and he's going to draw the line in the sand and put his foot down. That's what we're to expect. That's coming up very soon, I believe, according to all the people I trust. They say, hey, look, we're down to the wire. There's all these signs in the scriptures about when that's supposed to be fulfilled. And, you know, the point is we need to get ready for it. And how do you ready yourself for it? You pray about God's opinion. Get in his heart and mind. Look through his eyes. Jesus said, whatsoever we do or fail to do for the least of these, we do or fail to do for him. Okay? And what does that mean? I mean, we look at the downtrodden, the dispossessed, the disenfranchised, the desperately poor, the homeless out there. That's Jesus Christ. We call ourselves a Christian nation. For what? For shame. It's the stupidest thing in the world. And we wonder why bad things keep happening. We got this pandemic that won't go away and all the economic distress that's being caused. Okay. Friends, you know, God can lift his hand of protection. It's not him causing the problems. He's not responsible for anything bad since the dawn of creation. Only good, just to be praised and thanked for everything good. But I'm telling you, you know, he can stop it, but we've got to be good. We've got to take the steps necessary to lift the anger, the curse. It's not difficult to get into the mind of God. He makes it easy. His yoke is easy, his load is light. It's all simple, pure logic that a child can understand. So someday we're all going to be without excuse. The people running the show now, they don't prescribe that. They serve a different God, the God of this world, which is, like Jesus said, it is, for all intents and purposes, Satan, Lucifer, the devil. Okay, and they do it through the money. They control us through the money, an invention, a pure invention, a concoction, a conjuring up by men, evil men, to steal from righteous men. That's what it is all. It's ancient enslavement. This is how they do it. This is the power is in the purse. And these are not nice people. It's as simple as that. And they don't care about us. But it's a tiny critical mass. You got to understand how a tiny critical mass can control your life. Just look at how we all have to carry around a pocket full or purse full of keys. And how stressful it can be if you ever misplace your keys. Everybody's freaked out. I've freaked out many times about that. Why? Because a handful of criminals in your town, just a tiny percentage, would dare take your stuff, enter your house, steal your car. You understand what I'm saying here? And that goes for the way the macro policies are. Okay, that's a micro policy, basically. It's just an inconvenience we all have to deal with because there's thieves. It's logical you keep keys around because you don't want to get your stuff stolen. And even that sometimes doesn't stop them. But it's with these people, too. This is the keys they have is through the money supply. You understand? And they're working in the halls of Congress and Senate. So they've got a critical mass of people, the amount necessary to get the job done, to keep the people enslaved and keep them believing that they're the way and the truth and the life. That's the practical, pragmatic approach. The common sense approach is by just getting in line, complying and conforming to status quoism, establishmentarianism. That's the best way to take, you know, that's a smart way. That's a prudent way. And, you know, they keep getting away with it. These are people that have sold their conscience for all intents and purposes for a dollar. They don't care. They don't think they're going to have to answer someday. They either won't exist or they'll just be, you know, honored by their hell's angels, right? So they don't care. They'd rather rule in hell than serve in heaven any old day. So they're going to get what they have bought, okay, which is Hades, because if they'd be miserable in heaven and God's going to establish a heaven on earth at the renewal of all things, you see the problem, the dilemma that God has and what's got to happen here. There's got to be this separation from the wicked and the righteous, just like a landscaper separates the weeds from the cultivars, or a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, or on and on. You could use a million analogies, right? But you get it. At some point, there is a line in the sand, and God calls the shots. I don't. I wish I could sometimes. I really do, because I hunger and thirst for righteousness. I want to live in a world without any form of money. And how could it work? Well, it's as simple as understanding that it's God's planet. We're all God's equally beloved children. And what's a message from even a crappy set of parents would tell you, share, get along with each other. God's telling us the same thing. Share, get along with each other. So if we share it from birth, you understand, if you got your share of the natural resources of the earth while you're here temporarily, passing through, then you got to leave them behind when you pass, that we'd all be born unthinkably wealthy. There's a level playing field. It has nothing to do with dollars and cents, nothing to do with any form of money, just an understanding, a whole new paradigm. So when we serve each other, it's of our own free will and accord. We work for who we want, where we want, when we want, how we want. End of story. There's no big brother. There's no need for big brother. People are like, oh, okay, society, civilized society without any form of money. Well, think it through. You have the ability to imagine it, and that's good enough. That makes you without excuse. If you, in all honesty, said, I can imagine it. People say, but I love money. Who does? What fool? What idiot doesn't love money? And I get it. God gets it. Who does? Hey, you need it to live. It's a cost of living. Dissect the term. Cost to exist. The cost to survive. You got to pay somebody. Nothing's free. But according to God, it is. He has given freely. It's not his fault. He didn't invent money. He didn't create money. Evil men did, to scam righteous men, to steal their wealth, to enslave them, to control them, to have a one-up, an advantage over others. They're hypocrites. And that's enough said, they're evil. And Jesus had all kinds of things to say about these people. He excoriated the crap out of them. He didn't condemn them, but it was a repent or perish. I'm your best friend is what he tried to shake them up. Don't you understand? I mean, you have a chance of an eternal life in paradise. You're going to turn that up for this ephemeral, fleeting wisp of time, this flash in the pan of time relative to eternal life in paradise? For what? You're stupid, and that's insecure time at that. You might be dead at any time. But yet there's a whole host of people out there that are willing to do that. Sell it all, sell their conscience, sell their soul for a loaf of bread, for a dollar. That's the world we live in, my friends. You know, with the elections near, I've got no faith in these politicians. They all represent a bad religion. And, you know, that's enough said, is that they're working together. There's only a handful of people that aren't evil in those high echelons of government, the Congress and Senate, the executive branch. And they're controlled by the money printing class. So I don't have any faith in the bad religion. I'm not going to get all hung up. When I was younger, I used to. And I say, you know what? I'm done. I don't trust it. The vast majority of these people. Okay, that's just the way it is. Unfortunately, that these people are deluded for the most part. They're just nutcases. The trick is to make sure everyone likes them. And they all fail at that. So we were more and more divided. They want us divided. They want us believing that the problem is Democrats, the problem is Republicans, the problem is conservatives, the problem is liberals, the problem is socialists, the problem is capitalists. Am I right? Isn't that how they do it? When at the end of the day, on the important issues, they stab us in the back like the bailout of